doctor will fix your pain.
Glass Doctor is a proud supporter of Long Beach schools. Call Glass Doctor for all your home, auto, and business glass needs.
Call the Glass Doctor, we'll fix your pain.
Did you know you can get up to a $100,000 scholarship from McDonald's? The McDonald's HACER National Scholarship Program offers scholarships to Hispanic students from all over the country and continues to provide educational opportunities to help narrow the gap that exists for Hispanic college-bound students. For more information and to apply, go visit this website.
Featuring head football coach Jacob Massey. I'm Tony McGill. Tim Delaney's usually with us. He's running a little late, so we're going to start without him. We're going to put him on the board here in a few minutes. But let's talk a little football. Picayune, everything that you heard that they were going to
be? Yeah, they were. You know, number four was as good as advertised. And, you know, they had some really good defensive players. You know, 74 showed up.
Oh.
Free safety was a pretty good player, picked off the pass.
Yeah.
Right out the gate, you know, but it's a game of inches. You know, we put that ball 3 inches higher, it hits Junior right in the hands, and he scores a touchdown.
Said
right
it
out
during
the
broadcast.
You know? So it's just one of those things, and I've said it week in and week out. The good football teams don't make those mistakes,
right?
You know, and we're not there yet. Have we made strides? Absolutely,
absolutely.
You know, I thought we kind of contained number four a little bit. You know, he didn't do some of the things that he was able to do against some other teams. You know, and we've got a lot of young kids playing because of our injuries, and they misaligned at times and got us out leverage on some plays, and you know, that resulted in them being able to score. Will going down second drive really kind of put a damper on the night, because I thought, you know, after that first drive we threw the pick, we came back, started moving the football a little bit, got it across their 50, started moving it towards, you know, the 30 down there to give us a chance to score, and then Will rolls his ankle. So, you know.
And he'll be ready this Friday night?
He's going to be probably a game-time decision. You know, it's just going – we've got to see how he's going to move on it. You know, him walking is fine, but you know as well as I do, whenever you start having to roll and cut and do those types of things, getting out of under center. But I will say this, I was really proud of Kavion the other night.
Him
and Jackson coming in a tight spot. And
well, we've been watching Kavion during the JV games, and I kept saying, I've watched him throw the ball 50, 52 yards down the field on the run.
Yep.
I'm little one-on-one time with quarterback coach, and he could turn into a real good
player. You know, when he gets the majority of the reps, you know, I think he could be
with the varsity.
With the varsity, you know, and he showed it in flashes the other night.
Yeah, he did.
But
he can run.
You know, our entire game plan got cut by about 75% when Will got out. You know, there's, and you know as well as I do is, you know, those JV kids, they are only going to know your base plays, and that's all that we could run. You know, but I was really proud of what Jackson and Kavion were able to do when they went in the ball game. You know, you saw flashes from Kavion of what he could be or what he could become, and we were really proud of that effort. And I'm going to tell you, the JV program, you know, a lot of our kids don't necessarily enjoy playing JV. They think it's a snub or whatever. But our JV program this year, we've gotten more out of it than we have in my other 2 years here. We've had kids that have showed up on film.
We don't Monday. Win JV games before you got here.
Well, we're 4-2 this year.
We're 4-2. We had a winning record.
Yeah, we were 4-2 this year. For the first time, we had a winning JV. And I think that's just, you know, each year we've gotten better in JV, and we've also gotten better in varsity. And I just think we're going to improve on that as we kind of go on.
A lot of room to build. Mm-hmm. Now, speaking of that, and I don't want to get off picking in right now, but I want to talk about the division and some changes in our division, or possible changes. But we talk about size and weight and athletes and all that week in, week out. I talked about Picky or Pascagoula. Their skilled people were bigger than our linemen. You had an offensive line on Picky Yoon, and we talk about Daryl Smith running the ball and having 18 touchdowns. I think he scored two against us, so he's at 20. The center for Picky Yoon was 250 pounds. The guards were 260 and 285. The tackles, 324 and 374. Almost 400 pounds. That's 1,500 pounds of lineman. Our nose guard, both no guard. Yeah. You have two coming in and out, 160 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, as a coach, and I probably know the answer, but how do you compete with that?
Well, you know,
it's week in and week out, and we're already busted up, and you've got kids in there.
Well, and I think you kind of got to look at, you know, our record against 4A teams this year is 2-2. Our record against 5A and up is 0-5. Yeah. So, you know, that could get –
There's your size, your strength, and all that. And I know y'all working that weight room. Man, I think in this program, the most impressive thing where we've leaped in progress is in that weight room and the discipline, too. Now, there's some discipline on this football team, and I think that you have to have those kind of things in order to build and to continue – to do what you're trying to do.
Well, and you look at, you know, teams that we played, I think just about every one of them has had some type of unsportsmanlike penalty, and have we had that this year? I don't think we've had an unsportsmanlike penalty yet this year, and I'm proud of that. But
Coach Delaney talks about that all the time, about discipline, because he coached at Nicholls State and Tulane University, and he talks about the importance of that.
Now,
we talk about it a lot.
We have had some offside penalties, but I think that was more – that's been our freshman offensive lineman.
It has,
jumping offsides.
You got two of them that do it a little bit. But, man, the maturity, the experience at this level on these younger guys is going to – will reap the benefits. Yeah.
Well, I think you'll see in the first four games next year that the ball game's going to slow down a pretty good bit for those, you know, freshman offensive linemen, as fast as it's going right now for them.
Did you get a chance to walk in Picky Yoon's field house?
I didn't, but I was able to. Me and Coach Stoddard talked for about 30, 45 minutes before the game, and, you know, he was telling me about all that. But they've got a collegiate-sized weight room, you know,
Overlooking
the field. They've got about 20 racks in there to where they can roll, you know.
Yeah.
You know, you can put 60, 70 kids in there with those 20 racks. And
right now, you put defense in for an hour, and then you have to go back and get the offense in, start all over.
But they've got a varsity varsity locker room, a ninth grade locker room, coaches' offices, film rooms, all that type of stuff. It's a
$2 million state-of-the-art facility. Maybe we can dream. Okay, before we go, I want to get off Picky Yoon, or I'm going to go to Hancock. But before we do that, the reclassification of our division, and they're talking about it now. I thought it was set in stone, but you said it's probably still being worked out. But it looks like we might lose. I think West Harrison's going to go to 7A.
Yeah, and that's then, that's what it looks like. And there's a chance, just looking at our numbers, and this is all speculation, and based off of the, you know, it's kind of like the election, you know, you're just trying to get a rough estimate of where these candidates are. It's the same thing with this. A poll, it is. You know, you're looking at, you know, we know what our number is, what we turned into the state.
Yeah.
We don't know what everybody else's number is, but we're looking back at what they turned in the last time they did reclassification, which was in 2022, and our numbers have fallen where other people's, you know, we know West Harrison's gaining numbers.
Right.
We know Pascagoula and Hancock are gaining numbers. I don't know where they're going to end up, but we're going to be somewhere towards the bottom of 6A again, or maybe one of the larger 5A schools. So that's kind of where we're looking at. But if West Harrison, the rumor right now is West Harrison goes 7A and then PRC bumps over, instead of them having to go to the Jackson metro area region, they just bump over and take West Harrison's spot, which makes the most
Pearl
sense.
Pearl River Central.
Pearl River Central. Yeah,
Blue Devil.
They'll bump over and take that spot. Yeah. And they've been, look, they've kind of turned it around, so to speak. You know, I think they started the year off 0-5, and I think they've won two ball games here lately. So, you know, that'll be another tough opponent for us in, you know, in our division. But, you know, people ask me all the time, don't you want to go to 5A? You know, I'd rather stay in this, because we're like, there's a sense of comfort with knowing the familiarity of who you're playing.
Yeah.
You know, Deuce is graduating. That's a good thing. Number four from Picayune, thank goodness, is going to be gone. You know, Hancock's going to bring back a good bit. They'll bring back their starting quarterback. You know, I think Pascagoula, they're losing, you know, some skill guys, some defensive guys.
Including their quarterback.
Including their quarterback. And you know, we're losing one off, we're losing two off of defense and three off of offense. So we'll be right there. Now granted, now those are four key spots, you know, Dre,
Taj.
Will, Taj, those guys. But, you know, you feel good about having the numbers that you have coming back. So you replace all the defense and a significant portion of the offense. You know, I think SJ can step up and take Dre's spot, being that go-to wide receiver. Now, he has a different skill set than Dre does, but, you know, he was really good for us before he got injured.
I think Jaden Scott will be there. Gavin Simpson on the line. So, you're going to – you know, if we had any kind of size with Trey Ladner and Gavin Simpson, I think we talk about them every week. But that just – it almost destroys your season when you're the type of offense you run, and you run and lose those big offensive.
Well, and you know, I'll tell you this: you know, my one of my best friends is the defensive coordinator at Tupelo. They're 9-0 right now. They're in the, I think they're the number one team in the state right now. And he said, you know, he was asking how the season was going, and I told him, you know, we had 8 season-ending injuries, and he said, if we had 8 season-ending injuries, it would devastate our football team. So in high school football, you know, you lose one, it's tough. But when you lose 8, we're talking about a different deal.
And you're talking about key players.
Key players, all key starters.
Yeah, all starters. Well, look, let's get on. Let's talk about what's coming up this week, and that's Hancock, the Hancock Hawks. They're 2-7.
Yep.
But they're 1-2 in the division. We're 2-7, 0-3 in the division. You know, we see athletes week after week, and we laughed last week. Well, we don't have to worry about a quarterback, but that quarterback's pretty good to you.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to look at Casey Kanan this week, and just last week, and the kids, I think he's thrown 5 touchdown passes, but he run for over 100 yards, had 100 yards rushing last week. So you compare him, he's a Johnny Manziel, not compared him, but a Johnny Manziel type of quarterback. Mm-hmm. So we'll see another good quarterback in this division again.
Well, you know, what concerns me with him is we watched him against George County. That was one of the games that we exchanged. And, you know, when George County is having a tough time corralling kid.
I don't even want to hear it.
You know, that concerns me a little bit. You know, and their tailback, he's a good player. They've got some wide receivers. They're not as skilled as they were last year. But, you know, whenever he throws it, they catch it. You know, now they're not able to break the long, big plays that they were last year, but they're able to kind of matriculate the ball down the field when they do throw it. And then, you know, number 3, their quarterback, he's a home run hitter. So, I mean, he's gotten loose against Pascagoula. He's gotten loose against George County. He's gotten loose against West Harrison. So, you know, we'll have our hands full with him defensively. They're very similar to what they were last year. They're fundamentally sound. They're going to play, you know, their technique. They're going to play their assignment very well. They don't make a lot of miscues. You know, West Harrison scored, 69 against Picayune, and then they scored a good bit against George County. I think it was 50. Yeah. And then Hancock held them to 20. So, you know, with our division, it's a mixed bag of tricks, you know, week in and week out. You know,
tough division.
I thought George County's defense was probably going to be the best defense in the league. You know, we were able to score on them, and you've seen them have some guys score on them. And then you see Hancock, who I thought lost a good bit. They lost that really good linebacker. I think his dad coached over there. And then, you know, they're stopping people. So I really don't know what you're going to get week in and week out in our division because it is so tough. I think you've got some of the best coaches. You know, they're going to find a way to scheme you up to either stop you or score on you. So, you know, we'll just have to kind of see how it goes and play, you know, see what they give us. You know, they're a lot like us. They've given a bunch of different looks on defense. So, you know, we're going to have to be very good in our in-game adjustments to kind of take what they give us and try to find their weaknesses on defense. And then offensively, we got to put a hat on number three. That's probably the most important player they've got on their team. And he's a really good football player.
Good football player. I'm looking forward to seeing him. Wrap up the first segment of our show just saying, you know, we just keep on keeping on. You know, the kids don't like losing, but they're having fun.
They are.
And they know that where we were and where we're at now. So my hat's off to you. I appreciate everything y'all do. And just hope we keep everything intact and keep on because, you know, the future's bright.
Yeah. Well, and I think, you know.
You're building from the ground up.
The South Jones game took a lot out of us. That was a game I felt like we should have won. We had some misfortunate calls in that ball game, and you don't know, you never know where that goes. And I'd really like to see what happens if SJ, Jaden, Trey, and Tim, and Gavin, the list goes on and on. Like if we're healthy, you know, I'm not saying that we beat Picayune or George County. They're really, really good football teams, but I think it's probably a lot more competitive game. And you know, you want to have a shot to win the football game in the fourth quarter and see what happens. So I am proud of the kids. There's still a lot to play for, Tony. We went out right here. We go to the playoffs, which would be a huge deal for our program. Yeah. And we preach that to the kids is your season's not over. Seniors, you know, whenever you play your last ball game, for the most, Dre's the only one that's got an offer. Yeah. Like, it's over. Yeah. Like, you won't get to play organized football
this
ever
this Friday
again.
Night, the last time that these seniors will step on Long Beach High School football field is this week.
In a set of pads, it is,
In the maroon and white. So. Yeah, you can't get rid of them now. Mm-hmm. We used to end the season, you wouldn't see these kids for 7-8 years. Yeah. They're on the sideline now. No, last year's seniors, the year before seniors, they know what's going on.
And that's a testament to our program and what we've been able to do.
Well, I had a little thing wrote up for the seniors. I think I'm going to save it for the ball game for our pregame show. Because it is the last time they walk on it. And, you know, I'm approaching 70 years old, and I don't think there's a day goes by that I don't think about a play that I made in high school or a teammate. And talked to a teammate the other day. He was our running back. And as a matter of fact, I remember Mickey D'Angelo's first start at Southern Miss. They were playing Northern Illinois, and his son was on that team. So I had a nap on this team in, you know, Illinois. And so you stay in contact. You stay apart. It's a big family, and Long Beach has produced some good football players. And
high school football,
teams.
There's nothing like it, Tony.
There's nothing like it. There's nothing like it. And you know, at my age and as long as I've done this, Kenny and I talked 3 or 4 times yesterday about production, about what we want to do and what we want to say. It's a big part of my life. It's going to be hard to let it go, and I probably will let it go this year if we can make arrangements. I want to be a part of it, but I don't know if I can do as much as I do. I've been sick, so... but I want to say thanks, and everyone, thanks for tuning in. Kenny Triplett, our producer, but Tim Delaney, my partner, wonderful to work with. He'll be coming up here in just a few minutes. So y'all stick around, and we'll be right back.
right, folks, welcome back to the Coach Show. I'm Tim Delaney. Missed the first part because I got here late. I'm here with Coach to talk about a little football, and we're going to have some fun today because we're going to talk about that back pocket of his and what other coaches call gimmick plays, trick plays, whatever have you, Coach. And I'm going to tell you, it's fun drawing them, I know, and it's fun putting them in. We'll start with, I'm just going to show you one. And it doesn't have to be much at the college level. Remember you talked before about using formation to the field, and you all got this. Every coach in America's got this, but we're an odd team, Tony.
I love it.
Just put a good one there. Look, turn it back, turn it back, turn it back, turn it back. Up, and then right down that hash, play action. He's got the end. And you do it with Andre out there, out of the eye, Coach. They will never see that back coming. It's not but a 10-yard pass. But there's that corner. They're going to overshift to the field. They're going to put the make sure they're putting the rover to the field and run him down that hash. That corner's going to honor that and free run. Well, I mean, I know you got a million of them, so you got, I just want to get that one in.
And that's one thing. You know, other coaches call them trick plays. Other coaches call them gimmicks, but – It's a standard part of our offense. Sure. It always has been. We practice them every day, make sure the kids know what to do.
Hey, they got them in the NFL that work.
They do.
People
they do.
Jump up and down when it happens.
Well, and, you know, my favorite one, we've hit Dre on it a few times. We've hit Junior on it a few times.
And that one to Junior to open the game was that was a gimmick, huh, Coach?
It was. You know, and it was probably more you've got your –
standard play, but it was a gimmick.
It was, you know, you've got your deception, and then you've got your you know, just trying to get in a formation that gives you something. You know what I mean? But probably one of my favorites.
You usually see the fullback run a jet straight down the middle of the field.
But we'll do this right here. And we'll probably – same type of concept that you're talking about. We'll clear out here. We'll fake something right there and then run him on the wheel. He'll fake here, kind of half roll it, and then throw it right there. It's just, you know how it is. When the quarterback turns his back to the defense, they kind of lose what's going on out here, and they're more focused to here.
Yeah, and you're picking on this one guy.
That's right.
Make sure he's caught up in the world.
In high school corners, our corners do it. Other people's corners do it. They're going to chase anything inside. I don't care if they're in zone coverage or man coverage.
Right.
Probably one of my all-time favorites, and we called this to beat Olive Branch whenever I was at DeSoto Central, and it's a great –
See him smiling and me smiling. Gimmick plays just get coaches excited.
It was this is a great play inside the 20. But we'll get an empty and we'll take a wide receiver and put him here and just talk about formations and football. You've got to have seven on the line of scrimmage. So we'll take the wide receiver and then put, let's just say, number 77 alignment on here. And we'll half roll it and we'll run these cats off right here. And then we'll sneak him right down the center.
Sure.
You know, your tackle eligible is what people have always called him.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just another way. And look, I was told very early on in my coaching career, if you put a guy with no arms out at wide receiver, somebody's going to go out there and cover.
Oh, yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
So, you know, you can put a lineman out there with an eligible number. They're going to put
quarterback,
somebody.
Quarterback, whatever.
They're going to put somebody over there with him. But that was a good one. Kind of the one that we've thrown the last couple of years. Now, of course, we love throwing, trying to put our best athlete out at wide receiver and into the boundary. But we'll throw, to kind of set this up, we'll throw, some people call it a hammer screen, some call it a key screen,
slip
now
screen,
whatever.
Yeah.
But what we'll do is we'll throw that out there a few times. Then the next time that we do it, we'll throw a backwards pass. This guy will come here, he'll catch it, and then he'll slip out on the wheel, the good old double pass.
Yeah.
One of the probably more creative ones that we had was last year. This might not be politically correct, but we called it Hide the Midget.
hey, they got midget wrestling over in Hancock County. You seen that?
Excuse me. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I can't remember what we had. Maybe it was this right here. But we hit Edwin right here.
Uh-huh.
We motioned him across, act like he was going to seal the edge. And then on the snap, they ran like speed option. Will took the ball, stuck it in between his legs. He held it for a count. We went blocked down, and then he took the ball. It was a big fourth down play. But we stuck it in between.
Reminiscent of the fumble rooski.
It was. But, you know, like the rule in high school football, and I don't know if it's the same in Division
I. Can't advance it if it's on the ground.
Well, that's a deception play. Right. So you can't fake a fumble and then him have it pick it up. So we just took it, put it in between his legs, and we sugar-holded it. So, you know, we were all right there about 3 yards, sprint to the ball, run the play. Of course, you've got to have some type of reverse off of your best run plays.
Right.
So this was probably our second favorite formation outside of pro. Right here, we'll crack screen right here, and we'll fake this off of our trap. So he'll spin around.
Yeah, we like the trap. That's a heck of a running play.
We'll motion him as the pitch back right there, and as he's coming out, he'll just flip that ball, usually Dre, and we'll – have him seal the edge right here, blocked down.
Yeah.
He'll get a good squeeze. We get the edge. But any type of misdirection type plays.
You got a lot. Linebacker's got a lot to look at right there and to read. Maybe one day we'll talk about linebacker play and the problems they have in reading.
Well, I mean, you've got to.
We call that a split flow play because you got guys going two different directions.
That's right.
This way. Now he's confused.
And I think that, you know, one reason we haven't been able to get Junior going this year is he hasn't popped trap yet. And that's been an issue this year. But that was one of our best football plays last year, and we just hadn't gotten a lot of mileage off of it. Now, we've been able to run your outside veer and all that type of stuff, but probably my favorite trick play.
Wait, this is your third favorite trick play.
That's my third favorite.
Every coach has got a pile of them.
And some people might not call this trick play.
If there's deception involved, it's trick play.
Fake our outside veer here. He's going to come around, seal the edge.
Oh,
straight drop back, throw the post.
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't get any better than that.
It does not.
You know, we've thrown it.
Backside post is really good, too.
It is. But, you know, any time that you can.
That safety comes.
Well, and that was one thing that we were able to do against. We put this in the summer just for Pascagoula, but we got in the eye. And last year, one thing that we saw is, you know, they had that too high safety look, and they're at about 7 yards, and they're just, if the quarterback opens to your side, I'm running the field, I'm rotating here. So, like, we're sitting here watching film in the summer last year trying to get ready for the season, and I was just talking about why can't we just run some type of glance route or something just to get behind the safety. So we came out.
Before he can get there.
Yeah, and it's something quick. So we faked speed option. Will did a great job of setting it up. He took one step, gave a fake pitch, and then he turned around and we just told him, simple as it gets, throw it over the safety's head. You know, just throw it over his head.
Yeah.
I don't care what type of trajectory that you have.
Yeah, just get it or anything,
just get it up over his head, which was great. And, you know, you always have the halfback passes that you can do that we have. We have probably about 4 or 5 different halfback passes that we work
and
on
not
each
even
week.
Ones that you run, just ones you know.
Just ones that you know, yeah.
Used over the years. Yeah, I mean, folks, we could sit here and talk forever about that because it is the funnest thing that offensive football coaches do. Defensive coaches hate it because now they got to work on it,
but
especially if they've seen it on film.
You know as well as I do where most of these were created, were out on the practice field like, hey, this would be a good little play right here.
Because somebody reacted in practice a way you didn't think, kind of like the veer was invented.
Well, I'm going to tell you, like, and I may be giving this away to Hancock, but if they put this in, they would it would be really good. But they've got this play where they're running buck sweep.
It won't air until Friday, so.
They're running buck sweep, and they bring in, like, a bunch trip set right here, and they're doing the old college play. He's blocking down, he's pulling and kicking. He's blocking back. He's rapping. They're both cracking. And he's running. And the quarterback's just going to give the tallest play right here. Well, we were trying to replicate that the other day. And what ended up happening was whenever we try to do it, our scout team quarterback, he runs to toss it. He isn't looking early enough to do it. And he ended up running out here. And it was like a sprint draw action.
Yeah.
You know, so he's running out there to give him the ball like a toss. Our entire defense over pursued.
Slowing.
And then he hit it back this way, which I think would be a really good play.
Coach, we ran a toss sweep accidentally. Guards pulled and went the wrong way.
Influence.
Every linebacker went with him. And we got big against George County. This is when I was here Central years ago. So we put it in.
Yeah.
It's just a gimmick.
Well, and I'm going to tell you, they'll influence as well. So they'll get in this set right here. He'll crack. He'll try to seal the edge right here. He'll block down, pull, wrap, and then they'll run.
Yeah.
You know, and
yeah.
I'm going to say, you know, 90% of the time that happened in practice, they caught it the wrong way or the kids messed the
yeah.
play
oh,
up.
Yeah, and they
and
saw
it popped, and they were like, hey, why don't we start doing that?
Sure. To put it in.
So, you know, there's a lot of different looks, and this is something different. You know, you call gimmick plays, trick plays. They're all counter plays off of
yes.
what you
misdirection.
You know, you're sitting here. What was our best play last week? You know, we're saying, you know, 14 or 15. Well, let's have some type of gimmick trick off
sure.
of that 14, 15
sure.
outside veer look that we could probably catch the defense off guard.
I don't know if we got time, Kenny, but we're going to do this. Maybe you can cut us out or leave it in. But, Coach, one more thing. Your Hail Mary. I knew this would get him fired up.
It's
Big Ben is what we call it. Everybody else calls it the same thing, I believe. I don't know.
Ours is just like what the Redskins did.
Yeah, put that in for Tony, you know.
Just like what the Redskins did. We're going to have this guy. He's going to be your trail guy. He's going to be your rebound guy. He's going up. We want him to catch
it. Keep it alive.
If you can't catch it, you just tip it up in the air. These guys are going to go down, and they're going to be 4 yards underneath or behind him. So we're going to try to get 4 guys to the point of attack. We're going to stretch him right here. We're going to reach and run everybody to the right. Try to get out of the pocket just to give you a little bit more time.
Right.
He sets up. He puts the ball up to him. So, I mean, you know, we're talking about a 50-yard shot into the game, you know, or right before halftime. You want to put that thing up and try to have somebody make a play.
Like, it always looks like a bunch of folks are jumping, but on your side, it's
yeah.
just one guy, which gives
it is.
So there's
mm-hmm.
no collisions or anything. These guys are looking to trail.
And that's the whole thing. And we set them up 4 yards away from each other. So surely to goodness, by the time they get down there, their landmarks are still intact.
Yes.
And so, you know, he's just trying to get over there
just
and try
case.
To make a play. Yeah.
If it's
mm-hmm.
still alive.
And,
right.
and going back to the fundamentals of football, people might say, hey, why don't you put him over here? Well, this is going to make somebody ineligible, or you're not going to have enough men on the line of scrimmage. So you have to line them up here and bring them across the formation.
Mm-hmm. Ever worked for you?
Has not. Not yet. But
Coach, we beat Wayne County yeah. and Harrison Central for their homecoming off of that, only because this kid slipped and was actually 2 yards further behind
yeah.
than he was supposed to be, and the ball was tipped so far that he was able to shoestring it and go
mm-hmm.
in.
But that's something, you know, we work on Thursdays.
Sure.
You know, and kind of getting into more. I know we talked about this last year about planning practice. You don't work all of your clock management stuff throughout the week.
Mm-mm.
Thursday's your day to
that's right.
work on your clock management. So we'll pick a scenario every week. Like a couple of weeks ago, we did nothing but two-minute stuff. So we're
right.
getting it out there. And how we do it was we pick our 3 favorite pass routes and our 2 favorite runs, and we just hold up 1, 2, 3,
yeah,
4, 5,
quick
something as quick as we can, and we'll get it in our formation that gives us the best personnel to run those 5 plays
yeah,
out of.
Right, right.
But, you know, we work on this. We work on taking a safety at punt. We have in the past, we've worked on the free kick on Thursdays, you know, where you're
sure.
fair catching a punt.
Sure.
It might be something we want to talk about, some of the funky plays that you could have in a football game
right.
next week.
I'd have to deal with. Sure.
You know,
sure.
I saw about 3 weeks ago a team in Arkansas had lost their punter. He was out for the game. They were on their own 45, fourth down, lined up in field goal, kicked the field goal, and it landed on about the 3. So it's different in high school. You know, in college, whenever you kick that, they get the ball. If you miss it, they get it wherever it is.
Yeah.
In high school, if it goes into the end zone, they get it on the 20, or they get it wherever that ball is spotted. So you can line up
if
in
you
the field.
Get down there and down it.
Yeah, if you can get down there
sure.
and down it. So,
sure.
You know, I love those intricacies of the game. You know, the whole Dan Lanning putting 12 men on the field in the Ohio State game was brilliant. It's smart, which, you know, I know he has probably 30 GAs and
oh, yeah, an entire,
7 quality
yeah.
assistants that
yeah,
can go
sure.
scour the rule books.
Stuff up, sure.
So. But it's always cool to kind of learn, and you know, to the viewers, the only way you can learn is by watching football.
That's right.
And the more you
know a little bit about it, watching us and then watching it on the game and translate it.
Not that we know what we're talking about.
No, sort of. All right, folks, we appreciate your time. Hope you got something out of it. And when you're coaching your little league team, put you one of those trick plays in. It'll work. Thank you.